Welcome to Green and Red, scrappy politics for scrappy people. A regular podcast on radical, environmental and anti-capitalist politics. Brought to you by Bob Bazanko and Scott Park.
Hello and welcome to a special edition of the Green and Red podcast. I'm co-host Bob Bazanko. I'm going solo right now. And I'm talking to a very esteemed guest, a scholar and also a very good friend, Professor Clinton Fernandes, who's a former Australian Army officer in the Intelligence Corps. He's a professor now at the University of New South Wales. He's published extensively on the relationship between science, diplomacy, international law, intelligence. His most recent books include Island Off the Coast of Asia, Instruments in Australian Foreign Policy, and What Uncle Sam Wants, U.S. Foreign Policy Objectives in Australia and Beyond. Welcome, Clinton, and we have you here specifically because we're recording this on December 3rd here and December 4th where you are in Canberra. I believe you're in Canberra right now. And
I'm actually in a car park in Melbourne, but I'm ordinarily based in Canberra. But that's irrelevant.
And in just a few days, it will be another birthday for Noam Chomsky, who is very important, not just to you and to me, but to countless people globally. So Green and Red is doing kind of a little bit of a birthday tribute to him. We're going to talk to a few people about what Noam Chomsky's meant, both, you know, in the larger political context and, you know, even personally, what he's meant to us and to people on the left. So, and I know you know Noam fairly well. You've had interaction with him. We've communicated. I know that I shouldn't say this on the air, but I was last time I emailed him, I said, I hear Clinton's been giving you some exercises and diet tips, and he kind of made some kind of smart, snarky remark about that. So, but we'll forgive him for that, okay? But I think you know, you're being a taskmaster, you know, so making him eat his vegetables and things like that.
All I said was movement is medicine.
I'm sure he appreciates it. I just figured I'd open with a little bit of humor, but you know, we can edit it out if you don't want this in there.
No, that's fine. Let it all in, uncut, director's cut.
Yes. Now I know, and you've done work on East Timor yourself and Indonesia, so you may not accept the title, but I would consider you an expert on it. So, and I know Noam has been, you know, really important in that because he, you know, for a lot of us, that's how we found out that, you know, there was even this place called East Timor. He and I think George McTK, and in my personal experience, have, you know, been really instrumental in that. So do you want to talk a little bit about, you know, just how important he was in getting that out, just letting us know that there was something going on there?
Yeah, sure. Well, it's a good time to talk about Timor because the 7th of December is Chomsky's birthday. And of course, Americans know 7th December as Pearl Harbor Day. But 7th December 1975 is the day that Indonesia commenced its formal invasion of Timor. There had been a longer term destabilization campaign and an armed covert terrorism campaign. But 7th December is in fact the anniversary of the invasion of Timor. Timor is important for a number of reasons. Most importantly is that the West is responsible for enabling and supporting Indonesia when it committed genocide in East Timor. East Timor lost 31% of its population during the 24-year occupation. That's the largest loss of life relative to population since the Holocaust. There was simply no chance that Timor could have come out, but it did have one potential chance, which all struggling movements in the global South could have, and that is solidarity campaigns in the imperial countries. And that made the difference. The Indonesian archipelago had a number of separatist or independence movements, self-determination movements. West Papua continues. Aceh, for example, on the western end of the archipelago, South Moluccas and East Timor. But only East Timor is now independent. And that's because only East Timor enjoyed a small but very effective solidarity network in the United States, in Australia, in the United Kingdom, and other places. And the driving force, the driving intellectual force behind that was Chomsky. When Timor was about to become independent, one of their big backroom leaders said, the Chomsky factor proved the decisive point. It was the decisive factor, and it meant that we could not be defeated. The power was not great enough to defeat us because of the Chomsky factor. Now, that is just a shorthand way. And I'll tell you one thing. Noam Chomsky will never accept this correctly because, in fact, it's the other activists that did the organizing. People like Arnold Cohen, probably the most important person to be involved in the Solidarity campaign over the 24-year period. Chomsky always says he participated in that campaign. He's always said that the work of the organizer is the most important work. The intellectual, the analyst, the researcher can provide much needed tools, intellectual self-defense. But without the organizer, nothing's going to happen. And that's very important from the Timor perspective. People can write any number of articles about all kinds of things. If there's no organization, that's the organizers that are gone from history. My scholarly research, in fact, tries to bring that up to show, as if we were doing military history, how is victory achieved? Well, it's achieved through the organizer. The analyst can provide, and Noam is not any ordinary analyst. I mean, he has formidable skills. But it's that if the analyst can empower the organizer, but it's the organizers that are actually doing the work. The other aspect of it is, his work reminds me, because of his Jewish background, of the key question in the book of Job. And that's the question that the prosecutor called Ha-Satan, the Satan. Satan's not a person. It's a position. It's a prosecutor. Will humans be moral in the absence of incentives to do so? Will you pick a fight because it needs fighting, not because you think you can win it? Timor's cause was hopeless. But Chomsky took it because it was his country, the United States, and of course my country, Australia, but it was his country, the United States, that was responsible for empowering Indonesia's occupation and genocide. And that's why he took it up, not in an opportunistic fashion because he thinks he can win, but because it needs fighting. That's the key question in the book of Job, right? Of course, there's why. Why is there evil? But will humans be moral in the absence of incentives? And if you ask Noam, he'll tell you there's something else that is of relevance, and it's from the Analects of Confucius, where the exemplary human being is the person who persists even though he knows it is hopeless. That's a direct quote from the Analects of Confucius. Chomsky persists even though he knew it was hopeless. If you ask the guy privately, what do you think the chances are? There's no chance. Okay, and yet Timor is free. Timor is independent. And that's a lesson we can learn beyond questions of Timor, that you pick the fights that need fighting, that you are responsible for. If your country is responsible for even 2% of the problems in the world, you should focus on that. You shouldn't focus on somebody else's problems, because human rights people, especially the organizations, the big NGOs, allow themselves to let human rights sometimes be weaponized. Let's find out what somebody else is doing and let's criticize that. Probably the most brilliant chapter in any book that Noam has written in politics is the chapter on Cambodia in the books that he co-authored with Edward Herman, where he showed, there was another chapter on Timor and there was a chapter on Cambodia. And it was very clear that all the effort was going into talking about the Khmer Rouge and Cambodia, where nobody had any actual solutions as to what to do about it, but they could sheet it home to somebody else. Timor was something we were actually responsible for. We were aiding and abetting the genocide, and we didn't want to talk about that. The chapter on Cambodia in that book is in itself absolutely brilliant. So that's basically what I would say that we can learn and what I've learned, which is that it's not about whether you get discouraged or not. People ask Noam all the time, well, you know, what gives you hope? What about if you acted without hope, without a need for hope? What about if you acted because you thought that this is something that needs to be done, that there's a chance that what you're doing is going to affect your country's actions, and that's why it needs to be done, rather than just because you think it's easy to win? The exemplary human is the one who persists even though he knows it is hopeless. That's Noam Chomsky.
I think it's critical too to talk about these, what I would call like real issues, like Timor. You know, he was in Belfast in the 70s in IRA rallies, and he's been to Palestine, you know, countless times. And, you know, before I had him scheduled to come to Houston, and he was going to Turkey because his publisher was on trial. And I remember telling, you know, Bev, who worked with him at the time, I was like, well, make sure he comes back because he's supposed to speak in Houston. And I think, you know, now we're seeing a lot of, especially younger people who tend to be very critical of him. They, you know, they sit at their keyboards and this is their activism. And I think they forget that, you know, he's more than just this, you know, kind of left intellectual, but he's actually, you know, he's walked the walk plenty. And, you know, that doesn't mean, you know, I've disagreed with him. I think all of us don't, you know, see eye to eye all the time, but I think to deny just this incredible role he's had and these real issues. I mean, you know, people in Timor live differently now than they did, you know, 30, 40, 50 years ago. And, you know, I'm not going to paint a pretty picture of Palestine, but he's been on the front lines of that. And so much of what we know about what's happened there is because he's, you know, talked about it and written about it. He has an audience that, you know, yeah. I don't, and that, you know, most professors and most people won't.
You know, the thing with Noam is that I return to the point that he is concerned about the actions of his own country. He has never romanticized the Timorese leadership, had never had any illusions about the Palestinian leadership. It was more about an anti-imperialist form of internationalism, of trying to remove your own country's boot from somebody else's throat without in any way idealizing or romanticizing what those countries' leaderships do. Because in a violent struggle, it's the most violent and tough and intolerant elements and resilient elements of the resistance that survive. And those people usually wind up in leading countries which don't have great internal democratic processes themselves. And that's because the humane types have all been killed off. That's precisely what an imperial war or a blockade or pressure campaigns, maximum pressure campaigns, for example, in Iran, that's what they do. And so when you're trying to reduce your own side's violence against somebody else, you don't have any illusions about who's actually going to come out on the other side, because the more violent things get, the more likely it is that the most tough, brutal, resilient, militaristic elements are the ones that survive. And that is, in fact, what has happened. But Noam was never under any illusions that was going to happen. So he never made the mistake of romanticizing the emerging leadership of an independent struggle. That's including in, say, for example, the North Vietnamese. Once the destruction of the National Liberation Front of South Vietnam happened, it was pretty clear after that that who was going to survive were actually no longer the more libertarian elements in the resistance. And you know that from your own study. See, but the point is that you're responsible for the consequences of your actions, and not without in any way romanticizing somebody else's leadership.
Yeah, I mean, recently we've seen a lot of, you know, kind of self-described, you know, Marxist and socialist, you know, attack him as an apologist for Assad or an apologist for the regime in Iran, and I don't know where that's coming from if they, you know, follow this guy at all.
Yeah, look, I, once again, it's more that the once the violence starts, the resistance, once it moves away from nonviolence and it gets into violent resistance, it's basically the more violent elements that triumph. And that's basically the point that he had made. I don't know who these people are that say what they're doing, because I don't follow much of... I guess your internal debates in the left, but the difference between them, for example, you know, the things that you're saying and Noam, is this: being an internationalist means you are concerned about where those renewable energy minerals are coming from. You know, if the progressive side wants healthcare and Medicare for all and renewable energy and electric cars. Noam understands that it's coming from the Democratic Republic of Congo. That's where the cobalt is coming from. It's coming from northern Zambia. Is there any consideration about those people's lives, or is it all just about building a social democracy at home? Meanwhile, there are some subhumans, what Noam calls four-legged beasts of burden, who are providing all these organic, balanced diet, multi-nutritional, various foods for you, your electric cars. That's coming from somewhere else, and he knows that. But the general internationalism is what's missing. And I'm talking here about my country, okay, Australia, where, yes, we'd like to make sure that there is good healthcare, which, you know, we have better than the United States, but renewable energy and so on. Well, where are these critical commodities, these strategic minerals coming from? The general progressive side is blind to that. Noam is not. That's the big difference, I would say. That's one of the big differences between his approach and the approaches you've described are the ones that I've witnessed.
Yeah. Shift a little bit, maybe talk a little, just a little bit, if you can, about the personal impact he's made on you, because we talked to David Barsamian about Noam, and he said he was visiting him once at MIT, and some like junior high school kid was there for some kind of school project. And, you know, Noam brought him into the office and made, like, you know, a Nobel Prize winner wait in the hall.
And that's now, right. I know that. I know that story. Yes.
Yeah, and I think I know, I first made contact with him when I was still working on my dissertation, and it was just, you know, amazing, you know. And I know he doesn't like hero worship, but, you know, to me, you know, getting letters from Noam Chomsky and, you know, developing this communication with him was really incredible. And you know, at certain periods in my career, and I think anyone on the left, you know, we've all experienced where you kind of get pummeled. And, you know, sometimes you go back and you think, well, you know, people like, you know, you mentioned Gabriel Kohler and Noam Chomsky think I do good work, and it helps a lot. So,
with Noam, though, the anecdote you mentioned from Barsamian about that, I've seen it myself. You know, an Iranian refugee from Tucson, Arizona. Is sitting in line outside his office in Boston. This is before he moved to Arizona itself, of course. And generally speaking, I would be the last appointment for the day so that we can go and have dinner after that. You know what I mean? And I'd see these people sitting in line, and you have these high school newspaper people, and you have top academics, and they are in line in the order in which they were booked. If you're talking about the personal impact on me, I mean, basically everything I've described is a personal impact, this entire conversation, you know, the morality of a policy or a political program has to be measured at least to a significant extent by its consequences. What's the consequence if you do that? There was an issue that arose in the 2020 presidential elections in the United States. Who do you vote for? And the point that Noam always makes is that you don't vote for, you vote against. You basically do your work of organizing, the organizing work, which is most important. Then you take, you know, half an hour, a break of half an hour from that, and you go and vote. And what you do is you vote against. And what you do is you're not trying to express your feelings and how you feel about it. You have to distinguish between feel good tactics and do good tactics. And the consequences of your vote are what's important, not whether your vote for example, Joseph R. Biden is somehow a measure of your moral evaluation of his program. It's rather you're voting against. And the metric to decide what the right vote is measured by its consequence. Not your intentions, its consequence. So these are the personal effects, I suppose, on me. But basically I've described political stuff, but it's half of it. The other half, of course, is linguistics, which I'm in admiration of. The other thing is, on the internationalism, if you were to ask many people, what are the most important human rights organizations? They would say things like Human Rights Watch or Amnesty International. I can tell you the most important human rights organizations in the world are the World Food Program and the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. Because of the billions of people in the world, those programs actually benefit those people the most. They have been neutered, they have been cut back by policies designed to cut them back. But you will not find too many people on the progressive left, or anywhere else, in fact, reading UNCTAD, UN Conference on Trade and Development's annual reports. In the progressive international, it is regarded as quite important, let's say, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Bernie Sanders are members. But Richard Kozul-Wright, the big economist at UNCTAD, isn't that. But that's the most important part of it, the economics. The fact is, the most important organizations, human rights organizations in the world, are not Human Rights Watch, not Amnesty International. It's the World Food Program and the FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organizations of the United Organization of the United Nations. It is very hard to find people who read their annual reports. Noam does. You look through his footnotes. I read his book, all the footnotes, and I go and read the footnotes as well. He cites UNICEF's State of the World's Children reports. That's how you can say that it would cost only a few cents to eliminate so many million deaths in child mortality. And then he counterposes that to people talking about the responsibility to protect, the R2P. But he actually always would read UNICEF's State of the World report, UNCTAD's Trade and Development report, UNCTAD's World Investment report, the Food and Agriculture Organization, World Food Program. That actually matters to human beings, not human beings in the United States, not human beings in Australia, but the two-legged beasts of burden overseas. That's the level of internationalism that I've learned from Noam.
Yeah, I think I always think of him and the great journalist I.F. Stone, who taught, at least I took it to heart, that you can find so much of what you need just by looking for it. It's not, there's no necessarily, you don't have to go look at it. There's no deep state. It's all in the open. And if you read the documents, if you read the reports, if you read, kind of the annual prospectus, they're kind of telling you what they're doing there. And I think that's yes. One of the, like I said, he and a few others were really important in kind of getting that yes. through.
Yeah, no, you mentioned the book that I did called What Uncle Sam Wants, and it was about U.S. foreign policy objectives. Well, it was basically a study of the cables leaked to WikiLeaks. Yeah. There's about 250 million words of those cables. I only read about 11 to 16 million words in order to write that book, right? And what I found with the shock, having written the book, was that basically there's an unclassified analog to all those diplomatic reportings. And it's Noam Chomsky's writings in the same period. And that book happens to be his 91st birthday present. It was my way of welcoming him into his 10th decade. But it was really amazing to see that what the diplomats were writing about in classified cables, he was pulling together by piecing all the various economic reports, the UNCTAD studies, all those other kinds of trade reports, and I should just say the Financial Times and the New York Times, because you've got to read them in a certain way, but those are good papers. And people would be shocked if they knew that there was a time when the guy was reading 80 journals a month and doing everything else.
Yeah.
80 journals a month. Not every word in every journal, but the key articles, diplomatic history in your field, for example.
Yes. Yeah.
He
would often lament. He's like, is this really what your field is like? he would say, is this really it? Like, yeah, I think it is.
the effort needed to put that together is something that we can emulate. See, the thing with Noam, because of the great memory, you say the word, I don't know, your area, right? Let's say you say the word military dissent, right? It's like there's a file that his mind draws out, and it's all in the front of his head. You see what I'm saying? There's like, normally you've got to think for a while, and it's all in the front of his head. But what people don't see is the effort it takes to do it. In a way, the mental brilliance isn't really worth admiring, because it's a gift. It's like being amazed by a 10-foot-tall basketballer. Well, I mean, there are natural gifts. What we can all do, what we can learn, is to treat people the way he treats people to come and see him. If you're an Iranian refugee and from Tucson, Arizona, or a school guy, a schoolboy for a school newspaper, or a Nobel Prize winner in physics, and you want to see Noam Chomsky, he treats you the same. he will take questions from people outside universities, people from, you know, what are called not prestigious universities, with the same seriousness as questions that come from the elite universities. Because as far as he's concerned, it's the argument that matters, not who's making it. It's the argument that has to be taken seriously. And when he's taking an argument seriously, it's a take no prisoners approach, because he's not concerned about how you might feel about things. He's looking at the argument, and if there's a problem with it, he will tell you exactly what it is. Some people don't understand that, but he, in a thing about him, is he's a very old-fashioned intellectual. He would take a day a week, 8 a.m. to 8 p.m., one day a week, to see students. He takes ideas very seriously. He takes students very seriously. He is very old-fashioned in that sense. You know, he is courteous. He's concerned about the idea, not the prestige of whoever it happens to be making it. What we can emulate, really, is that aspect, the radical egalitarianism of it. Rather than think, oh my goodness, he's such a genetic freak. Isn't that amazing? No, that's just, like I said, it's like a 10-foot tall basketballer. That's just, you know, that's something you were born with. It's the effort, it's the egalitarianism, it's the compassion, it's the personal responsibility that he takes. He really cares about a question. If I could give you a couple of personal anecdotes, not of me, but about other activists. On Timor, when East Timor was invaded, there were very few people. I mean, I'm talking about 6 people in the United States that were involved in solidarity for Timor. The key organizer in 75 and onwards was Arnold Cohen. When the Timorese refugees had evidence of all these war crimes and crimes against humanity and genocide and they were in refugee camps in Europe, you know, in Portugal, Noam Chomsky, from his own pocket, paid for their airfares so that activists could bring them to the United States, where they could be interviewed. A particular priest is the guy I'm thinking of. He could be interviewed by the New York Times in order to get the story out. When the East Timor Action Network was founded in 1991, after the Santa Cruz massacre of 12th November 91, they wrote to a number of people saying, look, we're going to start a new solidarity campaign here. The first letter they got back with money was from Chomsky. And it came in return mail. He would have received their letter, written a check, written a letter to them, and put it in the same day's mail. Okay? When the Philippines Information Bulletin came up for its annual review, subscription review, first subscription renewal was from Chomsky. It's the anonymous things that he does, that he doesn't big note himself. I don't think he's going to like me even saying some of this stuff, but I only say this so that people can understand that there are things you can do, even if you can't do the research and analysis and so on. The work can go on if other people are willing to support it financially. It's that respect for the organizer that Chomsky has. There's a big, big difference, for example, in that sense, between Albert Einstein and Bertrand Russell, who Chomsky does try to emulate, Bertrand Russell. Einstein and Russell's politics, especially, say, on nuclear weapons, was identical. Einstein would sign a statement and then go back into his office and keep working on physics. Bertrand Russell would sign the same statement, and you know the statement I'm thinking about, the Einstein-Russell Declaration. He would then go out and organize resistance. Right? That's Chomsky. There's a reason why there is only one photograph, big picture. Yes, there are a few family photos, but there's only one photograph, a big poster, in his office. It's of Bertrand Russell, because Russell is the kind of person that Chomsky is. You know, he actually goes out and organizes resistance. Doesn't just sign a statement and then go back into doing physics. Chomsky does the linguistics, absolutely. Actually, linguistics is a theoretical biology. But he actually goes out and organizes resistance. The thing that inspires him the most, I mean, having this guy is steeped in the whole of Western philosophy. I mean, he's read the whole stuff, you know, it's unbelievable. But what inspires him is just what ordinary people are doing. Peasant societies in Timor, peasant societies in Colombia, peasant societies in Vietnam. their struggles, their creativity, their ability to solve interesting problems. Something as simple as making crops grow under different climatic conditions. That's actually science. It's not regarded as science by people who want to steal their work and then monetize it by slapping intellectual property regimes on it. It's science, however. And he has deep respect for their work, for their political work, for their scientific work, for things like building fish farms, for carpentry, things that ordinary people are doing. These are actually technically difficult problems sometimes, basic bush engineering, you know, just improvised stuff like that. He treats that very seriously as examples of human creativity. And he understands, I mean, through direct personal experience in those fields, you know about what happened in Laos, I imagine. When he went to Laos for the biggest bomb, it was, you know, the biggest air campaign in history at the time. He happened to be there. There's a story that's been told. It's been written about by Fred Branfman. Branfman gave him a book which had various information about Laos and about U.S. troop strengths and bombing campaigns and things like that. He gave it to him in the evening. And then they went to bed. You know, Noam went to his room, Fred Branfman went to his room. They had dinner, he gave him the book. They met the next morning, they had to meet somebody from the American embassy. And the diplomat was asked questions about American air activity. He said something, and Branfman almost fell off his chair when Chomsky pointed to a figure, an American figure, in a footnote midway through the 500-page book. The guy had read it all night. Now you can say, "Ah, well, that's just the brains and the imagination and the memory." No, it is the will and the determination to stay up all night and to work at it, abandoning thought of physical discomfort. Branfman has also written about how when Noam was interviewing, he were interviewing refugees, he couldn't get people to interview refugees, but and their testimonies. But you know, Noam came along and did it, and he was amazed at one point to see Noam weeping in sorrow. I would not have said all this had it not already been publicized, because I don't generally talk about my personal interactions with him. But that's the level of consideration. To go all night if needed for something that might not actually make a difference. You see, you pick the fights that need fighting, not the ones you think you can win. The exemplary human is the person who keeps going even though he knows it is hopeless. And this guy had his dinner, got the book, stayed up all night, read a 500-page book, committed the key facts, the key data on American bombing figures and troop strengths and so on to memory. And he was able to confront the American diplomat the next morning with it. That visit to Laos has become quite legendary among certain people, and other people have written about it. But it is exemplary. There are people in Palestine who don't even know that he's a linguist. As far as they're concerned, this is a fellow from America who speaks Hebrew, understands Arabic, and he's standing with them at a time when the Israeli military is coming to brutalize them. They don't know. I can tell you, there's a guy whose life Noam saved, right? He doesn't know that Noam Chomsky is a linguist. It's that level of commitment. To me, what I would say is, it's not the brains that really matter that much, right? It's that level of determination, struggle, and the core aspect that you'll understand, but it's hard to explain to people, of judgment. Politics, as somebody once said, is like you're entering a chess room, a chess club, and there are people playing chess. And if you just stand at the doorstep and you say, "Checkmate the king," well, that's not a helpful strategy. That's not helpful advice. What the players want to know is, on this particular board, what move do I make now? That is political judgment. What Noam Chomsky has is that level of commitment, as I said, but political judgment. And that is something that is, that's how, you know, I'm sure you know people, you spend a lot more time among the activists. I think you have a greater tolerance for pain. than I do. And you can see all kinds of wacky ideas and bad political judgment that's being made. Perhaps that's what you're alluding to in your questions about what's been said about what American activists have said about him and to him. I don't know the details of that.
I think there's a larger conflict going on. You know, something he said, and it's funny because, you know, at the end of the day, a bunch of lefties, including Scott and I, you know, during the podcast, ended up encouraging people to vote for Biden, even though, you know, we're well aware of every flaw for his entire career. But something Noam said, which I think was really important through it, he's like, most people aren't going to go out there into the streets. They're not going to do activism, but they can vote. And if they're not going to do anything other than vote, then encourage that and tell them, you know, that they can mitigate harm
yes.
to some degree.
Yes.
Yes. And I think people on the left now, especially, you know, social media, so I think in many ways a very malignant force that way. Kind of have these ideas about purity and you're not doing enough, or they get into these arguments over minutia, but they're not really doing anything. And you know, I think
they need to get out of the United States and come to the global South.
Well, we're talking about Americans here, but I think they don't. You know, I mean, well, you know, I've been a visiting professor in Venice twice. There's the flag back there to show it, right? And the first time I was there in the second class, I forget what point I made, but I mentioned Chomsky's name and the class just looked and nodded. I looked and I said, you all know who he is. And everyone in there did. And these are 18, 19 year old, you know, Italian students who were in their first or second semester, you know, at Ca' Foscari University of Venice. And, you know, in an American classroom, that's utterly unimaginable. So he's made this impact. And I think, you know, I think that's important for all of us. Like, you do what you can. And if, you know, if you don't think you can do enough or make a cataclysmic change, well, do what you can. I once had somebody say that to me. He's like, you know, do you think you can do what Noam Chomsky did? I said, well, of course not. He said, well, then do what you can, you know?
Yeah. But that's the point though, right, Bob? It's you measure the ethics and the morality by the consequences. And the consequence of getting people to vote, if that's all they do, well, that has a positive consequence. So you do that. You know, and it's not a hard decision, but that's the point about judgment, you see, which is something that is this elusive element in politics. It's an elusive element. But the thing about the difference between Trump and Biden, it's an interesting point because there's the final words of a movie called Manufacturing Consent is where Noam Chomsky says something. He's talking about people who are struggling in the global South. The generally insular so-called activists in your country and mine don't know about. And what he says is, they rely for their survival on a very thin margin of dissidence and turbulence in the imperial societies. And how large that margin is up to us. It makes a very big difference in the global South if one person is the president and somebody is not. You can say, well, there's no real difference. So, you know, all I'm going to get is Medicare or whatnot. But foreign policy, no. Slight differences in a powerful country have major impacts overseas, especially for a global superpower like the United States. They rely for their survival on a very thin margin of dissidence and turbulence in the imperial societies. And how large that margin is up to us. It matters if the United States is in the World Health Organization or not. Because there are billions of people who need the World Health Organization. I'm sorry, there's a car reversing. Hold on. It matters a lot that the United States is in the World Health Organization or out of the World Health Organization, because there are billions of people who need what the World Health Organization can provide. Now, it might seem like an irrelevant point if you're an insular, activist in Australia or the United States or anywhere else. But Noam Chomsky reminds us that we cannot play games with the fate of other people. We have to understand that small differences, slight differences in American posture or Australian posture in our region, especially in the Southwest Pacific and East Timor, slight differences make a big difference to activists and campaigners overseas. How large that margin is up to us. Noam Chomsky has widened that margin to his everlasting credit.
And that's a great way, I think, to remember on this birthday and to go out. We're going to have you back to talk about all kinds of other stuff, but thank you so much. Clinton Fernandes from the University of New South Wales in Canberra, who's in a parking lot in Melbourne right now. And this has been Bob Bazenko with the Green and Red Podcast. Scott's still with us. It's just tonight we had scheduling issues, so I went solo.
Give him my best wishes.
Oh, absolutely. And thank you all for listening in and watching. Yeah.